you're doing. I said good morning to you, and then I saw Tony. Tony, you want all the middle schoolers to go back with you? Oh, you're doing it right now. Okay, just ignore me. Back to good morning, everybody. Are you all doing well? Excellent. Well, we had a team that recently went to Kazakhstan, went to be over there with John Weed and the work that's taken place there. It was also kind of a place where Patrick Weed, he got to grow up, he got to lead the team. And so they got back a couple of weeks ago, and when I considered when to have them be able to share a bit about the trip, since we usually give a kind of a focus at the first weekend of the month, I thought, okay, I'm going to let people be able to hear a bit about what took place on this trip. So would you give a warm welcome to Patrick Weed and the team as they come on up? And I'll let you close out the service, or were you wanting to? It's not one of those eyeballs or something like that, the gift that you're wanting to
get. Oh, the surprise?
Yeah.
Were you in here for the end of?
I was at the end of last service.
Did you catch Dad's video?
Oh, yes.
That was a surprise.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
No one else knew about it, so that was a surprise. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, I have to be honest with you, this is emotional for me on so many different levels. So we put together a quick video for you guys. I did my best. Kendall and I were chatting. There's so many things I could have added. It could have been an hour-long video. We won't do that to you this morning, but I've got a video for you this morning, so we can go ahead and show that.
To me, baby, in your native tongue, sing the words of the wise and the young. Show me the place where your words come from. Love's a language, love's your native tongue. Feel your heartbeat, bang the drum. Open up your eyes and fill your lungs. The same word from where the stars are flung. Love's a language, love's your native.
Oh,
my soul, such a long way from
Kazakh ducks.
And they're not?
Oregon ducks.
Yeah.
Big difference.
Look at
big
the difference. Hair on these two.
What are you doing?
I am knighting V, Sir Kendall of the Kazakh lands.
That was Kendall. Hi.
I was going to call for that last video because that was supposed to be my high, but we were going to highlight how awkward Isaiah was the whole trip and how much fun it was, because I have so many videos of like where we would just like pan across the coffee shop and Isaiah would just at the camera or something like that, and it was pretty fun. But
so I've asked the team to do basically nearly the impossible. I've asked them to do high lows, so they're high from the trip and they're low from the trip, and kind of just what God did in their lives while we were on this trip. So we're going to go ahead and get started since we have almost everybody here. We are missing one person. If she shows up, we're going to let her run on stage and join us. But Kendall, kick us off.
So other than that particular high, I think, well, here, we'll start with the low. So my low, it has to be the travel time. I learned that I don't do as well as I thought I would with the traveling there and back. So for a point of reference, Kazakhstan is 13 hours ahead of us. So it is well past midnight right now.
Almost 1 in the morning.
It is 1 in the morning?
Almost.
Almost 1 in the morning there. And then to get there, it took us about 35, 36 hours each way. So needless to say, I woke up sick the day after we got back. I was completely wiped out. But, you know, that was my low. High of the trip, though, definitely just has to be all of the people that I got to talk to. It's a very big umbrella, I know, and it doesn't sound very impressive, but believe me, it is. Every person I talked to there was, once you get to know them and once they got to know you, it was just so welcoming. And it was like every day I would come into the English school and like the students, I would see them so excited to see you. They love you being there. They want to talk to you. They want to learn everything they can about you. And it was just such a blessing every morning to walk in, go, all right, here we go. And then in, boom, everybody was happy. It was amazing. So
our day, we're breaking up into two parts. We had English camp in the morning, and then we had a coffee time at night where we got to meet with people and just interact with them, play games. And that was a really good time for me because I like playing games, and it was just easy to sit there and they would interact and talk. And I really liked the English camp in the morning. I was with the little kids, the grade schoolers, and they're always full of energy. We had lots of challenging children in that class, and it was just fun to play games with them and be with them. And my low for the trip is it was just really tiring. We had really long days. And we stayed in a hotel, and the maids there are not like the maids in America. The maids in America, they just make your bed, take out your garbage. Well, here, they rearrange your room, they untie things, they just do weird things. And one day, I was really extremely tired, and I went to go get in my pajamas, and they were missing. They had moved them, but I didn't know where they moved them. I was looking in all the bags everywhere. We thought maybe they got dumped with the laundry. We couldn't find them, and finally Patrick helped, and he found them, and so I was able to go to sleep and get a restful night's sleep.
So my low for the trip, we have this phrase that we like to say, welcome to Kazakhstan. And basically everything was changing on the, just right then and there. Patrick's like, we're eating here for dinner. Oh, wait, nope. Plans have changed. We're eating there. No explanation, just everything was changing rapidly. Sometimes we wouldn't leave the house, like we want to probably go tour the city, but we couldn't because the driver, there was a miscommunication, and welcome to Kazakhstan. My high for the trip is just connecting with people. My dad played for basically almost about an hour with girls in the foster home, didn't speak any English, just played. I was just sitting there playing with them, didn't say anything. I met this kid named Harmilan, who was my best friend there, and I still talk to him today, but I just connected with him so well. And then on the last day, he came up to me, hugged me, and said, I'm really going to miss you when you move back.
All right, so I'd have to probably agree with Kendall about the low. I mean, one of my main lows was the travel time. Coming back 35, 36 hours, we decided we were going to be real smart and stay up the whole night before to get on the plane and sleep. And I don't sleep on planes, I found out. So I was like, I don't know, 60 hours it seemed, with like 2 hours of sleep. Because I came back and went straight to work the next morning, and we didn't get back till like 5. So that was a lot of fun. That, and then like there's just some cultural differences that I don't do well with, we'll just say. And so just dealing with that kind of stuff was a shock to me. My high was just the connections. I mean, the connections that we all got to make as a team, and then watching the connections that everybody got to make with everybody else there. I connected with people on the team. Me and Caleb and Maddie played The Rock for hours and hours, a new card game they taught us with the people in the coffee shop. I mean, and that was their way of connecting with us, and it was great. It was a lot of fun.
So my high and low for the trip are pretty much the same thing. But before I get into that, I really have to tell you a story, otherwise my mom will be very mad. So we're sitting in the coffee shop playing games, and I start doing this. And every single person in the coffee shop started doing that, and we ended up singing We Will Rock You. And I had to share that. But my real high and low was at the end of the trip, all of the kids on the last night of the English camp were getting picked up by their parents, and they all had tears in their eyes. And it brought a lot of us on the team to tears. But at the same time, as that was such a sad moment because we might not see them again, it was also a really cool moment because we realized we were having such a big impact on their lives from being there.
Oh, boy, thanks. So my low was probably, along with what others have said, probably not being able to speak over there. Like, English is newly one of the national languages there, but a lot of people don't speak it. So there were many situations where I was lost, not being able to explain myself. So we went to this Russian Orthodox church just to kind of observe it, and it was like in service, and we walk in with our backpacks and our cameras and all our stereotypical American touristy stuff, and I think it's Kendall and me, we're just like standing, and this lady comes up behind us and like grabs our arms and sings something to us, and I thought she was yelling at me for some reason, because obviously. And so I'm trying to like disappear into the wall and not be there. And when we left, Patrick was explaining like she was just kind of encouraging us to go further into the congregation. Like, oh, well, that would have been nice to know, but oh well. Uh-oh.
Just imagine Caleb and I, where we're standing there, someone's talking to us, and we're like, and she's like pushing us forward, and we're just like, da, like no idea what's going on.
Yeah. And Susan and I got tasked with handing out flyers to encourage people to come to the English cafe. And so the flyers all in Russian and Kazakh. And so I'm just walking up to these people like, here, the English club at 7 o'clock. And they say something. I'm like, at 7. And then I would just continue for like an hour. That was a hard time. But one of my highs was just, God really opened my eyes to the difference that I could make over there. Like when I think of missions trips, I think of like evangelizing and bringing people to Christ. And I definitely don't see those as my strengths, being like a spokesman or really being able to, I don't know, minister to people that way.
And, or not speak Russian.
Or, yeah. That's nearly impossible. But during my time there, there was a couple of people that talked to me, and some of them were like, oh, I want to come to America because of you guys. Or I think Patrick said the first night we were there, someone said, we haven't seen anybody have this much fun without being drunk. So that was kind of funny, just to see that we just get to go there and just share the love of God and be a light And we don't have to be drunk or speak Russian in order to make people smile and make a difference. So it just opened my eyes to the fact that I can make a difference even though I'm not ministering blatantly or in Russian.
So I had a little bit of a different trip than everyone else because I took care of my three girls on the trip and we stayed at my father-in-law's house and they stayed in a hotel and I did a lot of childcare. But it was interesting to me to see how our trip was impacted, how we kind of were stopped a lot, the welcome to Kazakhstan thing. It was a lot of switching and a lot of change. And that's hard when you're already throwing yourself way out of your bubble. And it definitely, to me, felt like just roadblocks for us to get through. So my roadblock, my low, was on the trip there. My youngest, my five-year-old, got sick, like really bad sick. Like she was throwing up and having diarrhea in the air on the flight and on our sisters, which then you have to deal with a multiple child that's upset because she got thrown up on. And then in the airport, which if you want to know, Istanbul Airport does not have anything sun-dries at all. Like you just don't expect it. Susan got some diapers off someone. She used no English and no language at all and was able to get some diapers for us. And then also on the flight to Kazakhstan, so like going through customs with a child that's sick. So that was not a fun way to start my journey, but we definitely got through it. And I think my high was the fact that even though I did have a different trip than the rest of the team, my kids were able to experience Kazakhstan, which was so cool for them. They got to experience so many things that their dad grew up with. Micah ate lamb and she called it bubble gum because it was chewy. she kept calling it bubblegum. And Yael like reached out of her bubble so much and she tried so many new cool things. And then we also got to spend time with their cousin, my niece. My sister-in-law is a single mom who lives there. And to be able to love on her and love on her niece, even though she didn't appreciate all the ways I parented and loved her, it was still, I think, a good blessing that we were able to go and do that for them. So.
And I had a really hard time thinking of a low because even the lows were pretty awesome. It was such a good experience. Well, I finally did come up with one about halfway through. They brought McDonald's for lunch, and I don't eat McDonald's ever. I'm a runner, I'm healthy, and I suffered the rest of the week, and I'm pretty sure that's what started it. So. So for high, I actually kind of wanted to jump in on Isaiah's real quick because there was a girl there the last night in the coffee shop, and we were talking. She was 11 years old, just a sweet little girl. In fact, I think he was pictured with her up in one of the pictures. Sophia, yeah. And she was talking a little bit, and then she's like, well, so when are you guys leaving? And I was like, well, we have to leave tomorrow night at 2 in the morning, and she just started bawling. And it was really cool to see the effect we had on them, the fact that they were happy we were there. I mean, we made an impact. I think my biggest high, though, is we went to visit an orphanage / foster home and 2 hours north of there. And we each picked a gift that was aged, and we were going to pass the gifts out to somebody when they called the kid's age. And I had a little sticker book that I was thinking, well, look at all these other cool toys. And so I get the girl that I'm going to give it to, and I go give it to her. And it was really cool because she was excited. And in fact, I saw it in the video. I didn't notice it until this one. And she was up there playing with it with her sister, going through it, and they were happy. I also loved to see the fact that all those kids loved each other. They were a big family. It was nothing like an orphanage. It was really good experience, and it was really fun to bless them, so.
Thanks. I just want to show you something.
What am I asking for, right? Okay.
And before I give it back, I thought I was going to have to use that after McDonald's.
They don't come in your size, Brian.
Moving on.
So many highs. The food was so delicious and so filling, and they would be bringing you another meal before you even finished digesting the first meal. So, such good tastes, all the connections that were made. For me, the difficulty was being out of my comfort zone. But where we were staying was such a beautiful resort. It was a spa. They had this pool. And I acclimated to the time zone almost immediately. So I'd be up at 5 o'clock and I'd bring my stuff out to the pool. Nobody smiled, nobody acknowledged. There's these same four pool boys and their babushka grandmother, who I assume was their ride there. Scowl, look away, nothing. By day four, I started getting smiles. And so it just felt like a personal breakthrough. So that morning time was really essential for me because the days were so spontaneous. We didn't know what was coming. It was my connecting time with God so I could be refreshed. Why am I here? This is not a vacation. This is a mission trip. I'm not supposed to feel comfortable. I'm supposed to be stretched and available. And it grounded me because those days were long. They started, well, you know, for me, it started at 5 a.m. And by the time my head hit the pillow at 11, I was out. And we started it all over again the next day. So it was a way for God to say, I need you here. I need you doing what you're doing, and there's somebody that you're going to connect with, and it's going to be very valuable, so just be in it.
That's good. I figured I would do it as well, although it's really hard. Probably my low, kind of like what my wife shared. We go, and we take my kids with us, and their grandfather's there, and he's like, you're not bringing my grandkids and having them stay at a hotel. They're staying with me. And I was like, okay, Dad, that's cool. I get it. But for me to be with the team, what it meant was my wife and I were not together most of the trip as far as where we were sleeping. So that was probably my low. My biggest high, I mean, there's tons, right? From my kids seeing where we live, where I grew up, to my friends hearing about the place I've talked about for forever. My biggest high, though, was sitting with my dad. We ran into a pretty big financial kind of hiccup on the trip, and he was really nervous about it. And my wife and I had kind of prepped for what would we do if, and we had all these different backup plans. And so when this happened, it was so fulfilling to me to be able to see when my dad presents this problem and be able to go, no problem, it's all good. We got this, this, and this signed up or set up, and we're going to take care of it. And to see the relief on his face of just, oh, okay, we're going to be okay. Like, that was a major high for me. When I look at this trip, and there's one quick thing I want to say before I go any further. If you are interested in missions and would like to join the Missions Council of Springfield Faith Center, there are no requirements to join the Missions Council of Springfield Faith Center. You just have to let me know. All we ask is that you stay with us for 2 years for consistency, but other than that, if you have a heart for missions, and that just means from going to loving them from here, anything, please let me know. Other than that, though, you've heard a lot of different pieces. We got to do a lot on this trip. We got to help with the school and the camp that they ran. We got to help with going to this foster home and loving on these kids. We got to do a lot of different things, but I wanted to help you see the purpose of why we went on this trip, some of the purposes for these multiple trips we've been doing. The best way for people to be able to encourage and love on our missionaries is to go and see where they live and to understand what their life is like. And so what I've done, and I'm going to have the team share again. Don't worry, I'm conscious of time. I promise we'll get out of here for lunch. I want them to share some of their observations, some of what they saw in John Weed's life, and even more so kind of what they saw God doing either through John Weed or through what God is just doing in Kazakhstan in general. So we're going to go backwards so the microphone goes. So Susan, I'll let you kick it off.
So we had a lot of opportunity to have conversations with John. And I learned he served in Africa and in Egypt. And when he was in a hotel in Kazakhstan before he moved his family there, he said, I heard God say, this is where you're going to live. And so he moved his entire family there in 1991, the breakup of the Soviet Union, and Kazakhstan is an independent country. And he founded a church. That church is still going 27 years later. He's now doing something new. The government has mandated that all citizens be fluent in Kazakh and Russian and English. So as you can imagine, English schools are popping up all over. But they're not necessarily ethical schools. And John said, I can do this differently. So his format now, he's still a missionary, but it's business as mission. So he has the English House. It's on the third floor of a building, which was about a mile away from where we stayed. So we got to see the offices that they run. He has a staff, some are believers, some are not. This is his mission field. The students that come in, the families of the students that come in, and his very staff. And then downstairs, two doors down, he and his daughter and his son and a couple of others have invested in English and coffee. So it's now a socializing place, which is an extension of the mission field. So his heart is to do what God is leading him to do. And he has connections with people, all walks of life. It's not just church people. There's government officials. A UN official is in his neighborhood. And he is exercising intentional development, intentional relationship building wherever he goes. He knows exactly what he's up to, and the days are long. We got to see that. But he knows what he's about. He's following the call of God at this point in time in Kazakhstan. He's very critical. He's needed in a very critical way.
I think that was the biggest thing I noticed, too, is that he loves people, and it was obvious. Like she said, he had friends in the government all the way down through whatever you can imagine, entertained them, blessed them. Everybody seemed to love him. It was brought up we had a dinner there, big party, and you saw some of the pictures. And each person goes around and gives a toast, and the things everybody had to say was just incredible. It was obvious that he'd given a lot to those people, and it was good to see that. The fact that he works so many hours, and I found that the reason for the English school is that's a way to keep his visa over there so he can stay there. And so he was talking, and this is something to bring up because something people could be praying about. He feels like his mission or his what he's doing now is so much different. Before, he was planning churches, being very, I'm not sure how to say it, but now he feels like he just has to stop, develop relationships. He doesn't have a lot of time to just go out and preach. So it's a completely different lifestyle for him, and he was looking to God to see, you know, how is this working, because this is different than what I'm used to. And anyway, it's obvious, though. I mean, we went to the church service. They had a celebration for, I think it was 27 years from when he started the church, and they gave a tribute. And a lot of it pointed at Patrick, but you could see that they all loved the Weed family in a big way. And so he's done a lot of incredible stuff over there, and it was pretty awesome.
Okay, so this is my fourth trip to Kazakhstan. So I've now gone a couple of different times. So I know a lot of Kazakhstan. One of the very first trips I made with Patrick with a different missions trip, we got out of the airport, and I was like, oh, that is why Patrick drives like that. Okay. He's gotten a lot better, guys, okay? But I met Patrick when he first came to the States and started learning to drive, and it was, anyways. So it was interesting to me to see the differences between when they were, my last visit, he was still in charge of Joy Church, and he lived near Joy Church, and then now this visit, he's doing business as missions and this English house, and he lives all the way across town from it, and that was the thing that spoke to me. It's crazy over there. We didn't take car seats for our kids. They like zip in and out of traffic, and you're just like, okay, I'm holding on. And it was great because they shuttled me and the kids so much and back and forth and tried to make us comfortable. But just the craziness of life, that it is so different than what we live here in the States. And we do get kind of comfortable in what we do. And just that observation of, again, of like, this is hard. This is not easy. And they are doing it with God, and they are doing it with God under the radar, where we can very easily talk about freedom of expression and freedom of speech here in the States, even though, yeah, we get kickback from friends that aren't Christians or other Christians have opinions about how we're Christians. But they just can't right now because it's not very safe for them to do that, or it's not really acceptable, or they're going to really cut relationships.
And so to just see that, it's very different than the last time I went to Kazakhstan. So that was a very cool observation this time.
So a lot of people have talked about John Weed's life, but when I went, I had the premonition that he was like a pastor over there, which is true, but I didn't realize the extent of what he does. They've gone into the English school that he teaches at and the English cafe that they've started, and it just kind of opened my eyes to he'd be up, you know, 6 or 7 in the morning and dealing with whatever that day dealt him, the whole welcome to Kazakhstan spontaneity of every day, and then going to the cafe and just loving on people all day long and not getting home until late, and then starting it all over the next day. It just kind of opened my eyes. And then learning about how he went to Kazakhstan, not knowing the language at all, and started a church, and it wasn't till what, a year later that he went to college? Couple years later that he actually went to college for some extensive Russian studies and Kazakh studies to actually learn the language. And he even says now that like his grammar and his Russian's not the best, but he was just pretty inspiring. And to start a business without having any business background, he introduced us to one of his friends whose name was Rudolf from Austria, who was really helping him with his school. And it was really cool to see God providing for the, I don't know, the continuous changes in his life, going from being a pastor to now being a business owner. And I don't know, it's cool to see how God's worked in his life.
Something that I noticed about the Weed's life over there in Kazakhstan was that they had a surprisingly large house. And when you think about a missionary, you don't think that they're going to be living in a 4-story house, a fairly sizable yard and all of that. You're thinking tiny hut, no plumbing, stuff like that. So the thing about this was it's caught a lot of us off guard. We were thinking, how can he afford this? How does this work? How does this thing work as a missionary? But it really struck me how well he used the space that he had with hosting parties, hosting a church service in his own house. He doesn't just live with his immediate family either. He has how many people living with him?
At least two more.
At least two others living with him. He has hired work. I don't know if they live with him or not, but he has workers that help him because this way he can actually go out and he can be with people. He can start a business. And without these people that he has helping him with all this, he would have no time for anything. And that really, like, set me at ease with how grand it seemed like he was living at first when I arrived there.
Isaiah, real quick, do you remember how much he pays in rent for the house?
$1,000 a month.
Yeah, so just in perspective.
For me, I mean, it ties into everything everybody else said. There was a night 3 or 4 days in after I had talked to my wife, and I went to Patrick's room, and I'm like, what are we doing here? Because we hadn't started in the schools yet. We were living in a resort-like hotel, and I was, you know, like everybody else, I was ready to go and, like, you know, have to walk a mile to go to the bathroom and probably not eat, which I kind of did anyways. I was just ready to do all that. And, you know, the first 3 or 4 days, Patrick's like, welcome to Kazakhstan. This is the way it's going to happen. And then once we started working and I got to see everything that John had done, all the different relationships he had made with so many different people, it didn't matter that they weren't Christian for him. It mattered that they were people. And if he could make those relationships and be friends with those people and work in business with those people and inspire them in any way he could, that's what he did. And through that is how he's building this new ministry. And so being able to see that, like, kind of put a perspective in my head of what missions really is, because, like I said, I thought it was like Survivor. I thought we were going to live on an island. Somebody was going to get voted off at some point because Patrick said that this was going to happen. And but it wasn't that. It was about going and like learning what the Weed family gets to go through there and all the amazing things they're doing and just seeing how that works. And so, yeah, it was really good.
One thing I noticed is I was ready to go help any way I could. But I was correct last service. They do have dishwashers there.
I didn't know either.
But I was ready to go serve, and at John's birthday, there was like close to 100 people there. And I was ready to go help clean, cook, or whatever I needed to do to help with his birthday. And I went to go step in the kitchen, and there was only females in there, and they shooed me away very quickly. Right there. But in Kazakhstan, men don't do anything. They just come home and they sit, and the women do everything. And I was ready to go help and serve and just do anything I could to help, and I didn't do anything. It was a struggle for me and my dad because it's just what we do. It's like we like to help any way we could, and we really couldn't do any of that besides serving the kids.
I also really noticed just the love of Kazakhstan that John has. It's not only for the people there and they love him back, but he also loves the country. And he says that he doesn't want to come back here. He wants to die in Kazakhstan. So that's his home now. And I also observed that missionaries are just really busy. It seems like they burn the candle at both ends. You know, they work from early morning to late at night, and then they just get up and do it over and over again. And I just see that God's grace just helps them to continually do that each day.
So one of the things I got to notice while I was, or that I got to see while I was there was on like the very last day, we actually got to go to Joy Church. So this was the church that John Weed started when, back 27 years ago, which was an amazing place. And it was almost kind of weird because it was actually a lot like this. Like, it really was a lot like this. The building was a lot older, but you know, every morning they would do, you know, Sunday worship. You know, they had a keyboard, they had a guitar player, they had words on the screen. Granted, they were all in Russian, and I couldn't understand any of it, but it was very much like here. But it was this experience I wasn't expecting, because I remember walking in and feeling the Holy Spirit in the room. And it was one of those things where I can't understand the words, but I can feel it there. You know, you can feel this there, and so you know he's there. So fast forward, and, you know, John Weed now is starting another church. He was starting a house church when we were there. So he wasn't actually there for the Joy Church, but they're in the process. They explained that in order to start a church over there, you have to have 50 people that are willing to sign a document and say, yes, this is our church, and that's how you do. So you have to have 50 brave souls to do it. So he said, we're almost there, but we're not quite there yet. So pray over that. If you need something else to pray for them, is starting his second church over there. But in that, the other thing, we've talked a lot about the how he's doing the business as mission focus. One of the conversations I remember John having with us on the very last day was he was talking about how we impacted the people at the English school. Because I know I kind of struggled a little bit with thinking, are we really actually doing anything over here? I think we all had that for a little bit. But what really put it in for me was at the very end, John talked about how he said that, well, you know, did you guys meet that one guy? He came in, he was on his laptop, he was doing some tech work for me. You know, just while you were here, he just came in my office after you guys left and just broke down crying and was like, and just said, my marriage is falling apart and I really feel like you're someone I can talk to. And then he talked about how Rudolf, because I can't roll my R's or anything, Rudolf, how he is a devout Muslim, But he but John told us how he said that after we were there, Rudolph said, you know, after all of this has settled down and everything, I'd really like to sit down and talk with you about some spiritual things. And there was one more. Does anybody remember what the other one was? It's just slipped my mind. No, there was one more, and I feel really bad now because I'm forgetting it.
That's okay.
I know, because we're running out of time.
That's okay.
Brian, what was it?
Well, I got to sit down with one of the guys that was, I think, from the original church, and I brought up some stories of what God's done in my life, and it just completely encouraged him because he had some things he was praying about that had to do with his kids. And it was really, I mean, that was one spot where I saw God use something that was pretty cool.
I know we're running out of time, so I'll just kind of wrap up what I was going to say. So the weeds, well, they're over there. So over there right now is Josh, which is Patrick's adopted brother, Natalie, one of his sisters, and then John, and that's their family. So when they would get up in the morning, they don't actually drive. Farazine, they're like John's right-hand man. He's the one who has the car. So they all, in the morning, get up, they get dressed, they have breakfast, everything. They get in the car. They go down to the English school by, what, 8:30 in the morning-ish, 8:30-ish. And then, like, while we were there, and I'm told this is somewhat normal, is that they are there almost all the way until maybe 10 p.m. at the earliest. And then they finally go home. So, like, they do put a lot of work into what they do. And so it was just kind of inspiring to see that and to see that, you know, while they do this and while we were there to help them and bless them, but just know that they're over there and they do what we were doing and they do it every day. So them focusing on the people and building those relationships is so important. So pray for them. Give them some strength and some energy to keep going, because I don't know if I could do that myself. I would have a lot of trouble with that. But
one of the things that I love that's come up, and in this service and didn't come up with the others, and a few people have mentioned it, this idea of, I love my dad, he called it BAM, business as missions. And I love it because as I was thinking about what to share with you guys this morning, there's one particular word that I started to look into, and that word is agape. And I love the word, and I'm going to share with you a little bit about what the Bible says about it, about what the dictionary says about it. But as I was listening to the team share again and hearing this business as missions, it started just to impact me even more of this idea that I wanted you to see not just what you got to send and say thank you guys for that. I also wanted you to see a new perspective on missions, on missionary life through the eyes of people you know. But then as I started talking about business as missions, I realized that a huge thing that I really want you to see is, and somebody mentioned it in the crowd I overheard, that you're missionaries too. That doing missions in business is possible. And so as you guys talk to these guys and ask them more questions, ask them about that. Ask them how that played out. Because I think it's a huge part that can start playing into your life of how do you start utilizing and having God be a part of your life as you're doing business. Many of the people on this team are doing business, are working. And so my hope is that that starts filtering in. But as I was thinking about how dad functions, John Weed's my dad, as dad functions, as how this team function, and how you can function, this word agape is what really stuck out to me. And I started looking it up and different passages that speak on it. And I wanted to read to you out of 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 12. And every time that it uses the word love, that's this word agape. It says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. The one who does not love does not know God, for God is love. By this, the love of God was manifested in us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us and his love is perfected in us." I went and I looked up, I was like, okay,
There's been so many sermons, there have been so many essays and papers and Bible college papers that have been written on agape and the thousands of different of definitions and what it means according to the Bible as a whole. I can't do it justice. So I was like, you know, it'd be interesting to see the pure definition in the Webster's dictionary of what agape is. And so here's what it says. The definition says that agape love is the highest form of love, charity, and the love of God for man and of man for God. The word is not to be confused with philia, brotherly love, or philousia, self-love. Hopefully I pronounced those well enough. As it embraces a universal, unconditional love that transcends and persists regardless of circumstance. It goes beyond just the emotions to the extent of seeking the best for others. If there's one thing that I hope you heard is that I believe John Weed, my dad, definitely has agape love for Kazakhstan. Natalie and Joshua, they pour it all out. This team exemplified what agape love is. No complaining, no. Like, they did amazing. I'm going to pick on her since she just walked in. Madison's here. Okay. I want to just give you, so to me, this is examples that you get to see with people you know of what agape love is. I'm really going to pick on her really bad. She's going to hate me for this. She just finished, was it a 12-hour shift? She just finished a 12-hour shift, drove home, and then drove here to be able to be here right now, to be able to share with you. Yeah, this is what they did. Drove from Medford. Many of these guys came back after the trip and jumped back into work exhausted. They were talking about being tired. They went back into work. They worked, I'll pick on her again. She worked a 12-hour shift before we went on the trip. Many of these guys worked their last day. Many people of this trip gave up their vacation days. To me, this is the example to be shown of what agape love is. Because the encouragement is that you can do this too, right? When we go into work, and I'll be real vulnerable here, I haven't said this, for me to come back and then go to my job, which is difficult at times for me to do, just motivation to go in and being tired and going back to just the normal, to me, that is something where I'm doing my best to love my people, my coworkers, and to try to be a godly example, to try to do business's mission, as you've heard about here. I want that to stick in your brains, that this is something that all of you can do too. I also want to use this time to say thank you. To say thank you to the team, to say thank you to you as a church for sending us. I was so excited talking with my dad about how the trip went. He started sharing with me just how thankful he was. I started writing things down, and it's a little bit of you're getting all the running jokes. This is another one. One of the days we were there, my dad was like, Patrick, I need you to make me a video. Okay, Dad, when do you need it? Like in an hour. Okay, all right, welcome to Kazakhstan. Now I'm making a video. Kendall, I need this. I need this. Susan, can you do this? And so I got to make this video. Then I got to turn around and be like, hey, Dad, rather than writing all this down, can you make me a video? So I turned around. So this is a little bit of a surprise for some of them. I think at this point only a few haven't seen it. But we have a video. Before we show it real quick, I want to preface this. First, my dad didn't know that I was going to preach first and then show the video. So he says something about that. I also promised him I wouldn't edit it. But it's a little bit just of a thank you to you guys. So if we can roll the video.
Hello, Springfield Faith Center. It's 12:30, 12:45 midnight on a Saturday night in Kazakhstan. And I forgot to do this video when Patrick asked me yesterday, so I got up out of bed, woke up, and said, Patrick, I forgot. He said, something is better than nothing, so this is something and it's better than nothing. So we want to say surprise, greetings from Kazakhstan. Springfield Faith Center, you sent an absolute awesome team to Kazakhstan. I've never seen a team come with such an incredible servant attitude and an attitude to do anything that they were asked to do at the last minute. I know it was kind of stressful for some of them. At times they just wanted to go hide in a corner or to rest, but they had an incredible servant heart and an attitude. And I'm so thankful. Team, if you're listening to me, thank you. Patrick, thank you. Springfield Faith Center, thank you. You were an incredible blessing to the short time that you were here. As you know, we thought we were only going to have a few kids for our English camp, but we ended up having more than 40. The week after you left, we had phone calls asking us if we were going to do it again in August. And we said, no, not this time. We'll maybe wait until next year. And I wanted to say we've had many teams come to Kazakhstan over the years. Patrick has been part of some of the other ones. Some good teams, some sad times, some awesome times. And you guys are at the top of the list. This was the most awesome team. The sacrificial attitude, servant heart, no complaints, no criticism. And I know it wasn't easy. And you've got to see a taste of our life here where things change in a moment. We'd never done a camp before, so your patience with us in doing something that we were doing, kind of shooting from the hip, was a great success. And we appreciate it. We thank you. This was one team. There are many of you, if not all of you, that we would love to have you come back here. If you ever feel like God is leading you to come spend a year, 9 months here, teach English, help us with our orphanage, help us with our church plant, reach out to the Muslim community here, please. I'll be praying, and if God speaks to you, write me, talk to Pastor Dave. By the way, Pastor Dave, greetings. I really miss you. Wish that you'd been on this team. You've got to come visit us. After all these years, you've got to come see Kazakhstan. We love you. Springfield Faith Center, we love you. Thank you, team. Forgive me. And while you were here, I wasn't feeling well most of the time. If you remember the first day you got here, I wasn't feeling well. After you left, I got worse. And just a few days ago, I actually found out that I've had pneumonia. First time in my life. And I'm just now getting over it. The doctor put me on some very strong antibiotics. And the last 2 days, I've been feeling a lot better. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your sacrifice of time, your finances, coming, learning what it's like in just 10 days of what our life is here like. We love it here. We again would say we'd love to have you come be with us here. I'm not going to take much more time. Patrick said, make it short because I want to preach. He said, 1 minute, I'm already 3.5. So I'll make it short and sweet and say one more time, thank you so much for everything. We love you guys. We miss you guys. Come see us. But thank you so much. We were so blessed. Bye-bye.
Did anybody notice that Patrick recruits just like his dad does?
Did anybody notice that my dad's a really strong recruiter? I want to echo what Dad said just one more time. Thank you, Springfield Faith Center, for sending this team. And I also want to echo this. John Weed loves Kazakhstan. This team got to go love John Weed and love Kazakhstan. You got to love this team by sending them. Let's go love Springfield and Eugene in the same way. God bless you. Have a wonderful day. If you need prayer of any kind, the prayer team will be up here. Otherwise, thank you for coming.